In this problem, we're given a car rounding a corner with a radius of 40 meters, and we're told this is on wet concrete with an approximate coefficient of static friction of 0.8, and the problem is to find the maximum speed the car can go around this corner without slipping. So the first thing I want to clarify is that we are talking about static friction. Even though everything in this problem is moving, we don't have any slipping between the rubber on the tires and the road. So as those tires roll along, the contact patch with the road is always temporarily stationary. We don't hear any squealing, we don't leave any rubber on the concrete. So this really is static friction. So we're given two pictures of this process. In the picture on the left, we have the overhead view of the turn, so we can see the turn radius clearly. We can see this section of the circular path of the car. But the more useful picture is the rear view. So we're pretending we're behind the car and just watching it go into the screen in this rear view picture. And the first thing I want to do is just point out what the direction of acceleration is for this car. So we've already established that when an object is moving in a circular path at a constant speed, it must be accelerating toward the center of curvature. And this is a purely geometric fact, and I'll post a link to the video where this was first derived. So that acceleration is centripetal, in other words, center pointing, it points to the center of curvature. That's how it looks in the overhead view, but in the rear view, this center pointing acceleration is directly to the left. So when we observe an acceleration to the left, this begs the question, what's the force that's causing the acceleration to the left? And forces parallel to a surface, those are friction forces. So this must be the static friction force that's pointing to the left. Another way to argue the direction of the static friction force here is just to imagine what happens if we push this thing too far. So we go fast enough where slipping begins to occur. If this car goes fast enough to slip, it's going to fly off the outside of this curve. And what that looks like from the rear view is it looks like the car is going this way, off to the right. Well, the static friction force must point in the direction that opposes that kind of slipping. So that's just a second argument that it has to point to the left here. Okay, so we have an acceleration to the left in this rear view picture, and we have a force that's responsible for that, but we need to figure out the details on the static friction force, and that requires a vertical analysis of the forces as well. So there's the force of gravity pulling straight down on this car, and it has a magnitude of mg. And then the normal force here is pointing straight up. That normal force does whatever it has to do to balance the vertical forces here so the car doesn't sink into the road or jump off the road. And because there's nothing else tampering with the vertical direction, we can see really quickly that the normal force has to also be equal to mg. All right, so now that we've figured out all the forces that are going on here, we apply Newton's second law in the x direction. So one of the most common mistakes in circular motion problems is that students will put in an additional force that they call the centripetal force. But really all there is actual physical pushes and pulls, and then we apply Newton's second law. The static friction force in this case does happen to be a centripetal force, meaning it's pointing toward the center. But we don't have to invent some extra force in this problem. It's a real push caused by friction. So when I look at my net force in the x direction, I'm going to call the leftward direction positive because that's the direction of the net force and it simplifies the math. And so I have Fs in the positive direction, and that's equal to the mass of the car times its acceleration in that direction. Now you might want to subscript that acceleration with a little c to indicate that it's a centripetal acceleration. And now we can put in the details for our friction force and our centripetal acceleration. And this is where we use the fact that we want the static friction force to be completely maxed out. It's about to give up. And that's what we have a formula for. When the static friction force is maxed out, I'll just put a little max on it here. That's when it's equal to mu s times the normal force. I'm also going to pop in the centripetal acceleration here. We know that that's v squared over r. And again, I'll post a link to the video where that was first derived. So now all we have to do is sub in our normal force, and I have mu s mg is equal to mv squared over r. And something really nice happens here. The mass of the car cancels out. And highway engineers are thankful for this, right? Because this means that the safe speed for a turn doesn't depend on what car you're talking about. And now if we solve for v, we've found the speed corresponding to the static friction force being maxed out. So I'm just going to do this symbolically real quick. We multiply both sides by r and take the square root. And v is the square root of mu s g r. And now we can sub in all our numbers. And we get 0.8 for mu s, roughly 9.8 for g, and a turn radius of 40 meters. And when we run the numbers on this to three significant digits, we end up with 17.7 meters per second. So if we attempt to go around this corner any faster than 17.7 meters per second, we're going to exceed the maximum possible static friction force. The tires are going to begin to slip. And we remember that the coefficient of kinetic friction is going to be less than the coefficient of static friction. So at this point, we should have a major slip that takes us off the road. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.